Hey, everybody, James Ward here, of course, and I wanted to take a moment to share something with you that I believe is vitally important, certainly not only to me, but to many of you, but also in the interest of our nation, friends. And so I want to take a few moments to share something with you, friends. Yesterday morning, as a matter of fact, and from time to time, sometimes God will give me a vision and show me certain things that are relevant to our ministry or to our nation, to his purposes. And that happened yesterday, not often. And I say that, friends, really with humility, with fear and trembling. It saddens me sometimes when those things are taken out of context or mocked or misused or abused, which is really a privilege for God to make impressions upon our heart. And so I share this with fear and trembling from a place of humility in a way that I believe that will be beneficial to you. It is never never my intent to hurt or to bring harm, but only to help and to heal. And so I want to share this vision with you, friends. Before I do, I like to make my disclaimer, which I often do, that, friends, I am a zero victim, apolitical preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of God. And friends, that disclaimer is becoming more important to me, friends. Number one, when I say that I'm zero victim, friends, politicians and politics don't trigger me. I understand on both sides of the aisles, there are many different issues. There are many different socioeconomic problems, but those things don't trigger me. I act, I don't react to them. And so I don't have any bitterness or resentment in my heart toward any politician, man. I love President Trump. I love Joe Biden. I love Mike Pence, Kamala Harris, President Obama. I have no resentment or bitterness in my heart that what they say and what they do don't trigger me. And so I speak from a position, friends, where I don't have any issues in my heart that causes me to lash out toward them. Secondly, friends, when I say I'm apolitical, that simply means that I'm not political, friends. I am not associated with any political party in any way. I am often reminded of the incident where the angel of the Lord came to Joshua, who was actually working for God. You could say that Joshua was on God's side. And Joshua asks this angel a question. It says, are you for us or are you for them? Are you on our side or their side? And the angel responded to Joshua, who happened to be working for God and doing God's will. But the angel responded by saying, neither. I'm not on your side. I'm not on their side. He said, in effect, I'm on God's side. I'm here to represent the God of heaven's armies. And friends, I feel that way concerning politics, that the moment preachers like myself, if we're going to preach the true gospel, the moment we get encamped and entrenched in political parties, I think this is just for me. It undermines our credibility as preachers of the true gospel of the kingdom of God in Jesus Christ. But it also puts us in a position that we are not able to speak into the hearts both of Democrats and Republicans. It's my will to see all of them, all people, come into the very center of God's will for their lives and for our nation, friends. And so I'm apolitical. I think, unfortunately, in America now that politics have become the new idolatry, have become new idol gods in America, very much similar to what you read in the Word of God, Chemosh, Molech, Dagon, Ashtoreth, Baal. I believe that politics has become the new idol god in the United States of America. We've replaced theology with doctrines of socialism and racism. I think that sociology has replaced theology with doctrines of socialism and racism, with, get this, political preachers and prophets preaching at altars of humanism instead of a holy altar of sacrifice to God, that the preachers of the gospel of Jesus Christ, like myself, have been replaced to some degree by the preachers of politics and the political prophets who are preaching their gospel, sharing their message through the debates, through ads, through campaigns. Friends, let's just say they're preaching a gospel of what I believe is this new, idolatrous religion of humanism and socialism. And this is a problem when Christians, when we submit to that. And friends, let me just say, I realize that I'm talking to perhaps two different groups of people, those who are Christians, those who are not. I have total respect, and I honor those of you who are not Christian. And perhaps that the words of the scriptures don't mean the same to you as they do to me. I pray that they did as a believer. But for those of us, I'm really speaking kind of to a Christian audience in terms of the authority of the scriptures and what it is that God is doing and how he sees what's happening in our nation right now. And when those of us who are Christ followers submit to the political system in America, I think it produces cultural Christians instead of kingdom Christians. And friends, that's a problem. It weakens, and it weakens the potency of the Church of Jesus Christ. Instead of being salt and light in the earth, friends, we become salt that has no power. Jesus says salt that has lost its savor, but then light that no longer has the capacity to illuminate and to bring brilliance and to show the truth of God's word in society. So here's the deal, friends. I had this vision yesterday morning, as a matter of fact, and it was a room of just many, many Christians, lots of Christians all over. And we were in a single file line coming up to the front of the room, friends. And get this, Jesus was at the front of the room. And in our hands, we had these, they were 2020 election ballots. Get this, it was very clearly, I saw very clearly in this vision that these documents that every Christian had in our hand, it was a 2020 election ballot. But friends, get this, the moment we placed that ballot in the hand of Jesus, when who was collecting those ballots, get this, the ink changed on the ballot, and it went from saying 2020 election ballot, and it changed once we placed that document in the hand of Jesus, and it said final exam. The ink changed. Now, the people didn't know it, but somehow I could see that from Jesus's perspective that the ink changed, and it said final exam. The friends, get this, that what was happening in the upcoming 2020 election, that somehow it became like an exam in the hands of Jesus. And it's interesting how the Bible sometimes talks about Jesus does sorting and sifting, friends, that he talks about the sheep at his right hand, the goat at his left hand, how God is going to decidedly separate people into groups. Jesus is always sifting and sorting people into different categories based upon his own righteous standard, friends. But get this, he was taking these election ballots, which were now final exams, and he was separating them into two piles, and had a big stack of exams over here, a big stack of exams over here. The stack on his right were pass exams that were passed. It was a pass-fail grading system, friends. He was grading those ballots, those final exams that were being given to him, and sorting through them. The moment they touched his hand, he put one over here on the pass side. He put one over here on the fail side, friends. Now, this is interesting that the standard by which he was grading these exams, every professor has an answer key when he gives an exam, he or she gives an exam. The answer key to the ballots and the exams that the people, the Christians, were giving Jesus was the scriptures, the word of God, that he himself is the word of God. So he was using the Bible as the answer key to judge how people voted in the 2020 election, friends. Again, this is nothing political. I'm just sharing with you my heart in terms of this vision that the Lord has showed me just yesterday. Now, friends, it's important to understand the significance of this is because Jesus is not a politician. He's not a president, vice president, governor, senator, congressman, any of those kinds of things. He is not an elected official. Psalm 2 talks about that. Why do the nations rage and plot a vain thing? The people plot a vain thing and they stand against the Lord. They've gathered together against the Lord and his Christ. And the Bible says God laughs at the idea of the political leaders of the world opposing Jesus. Friends, he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We vote human politicians into office, but Jesus has been appointed by God as the righteous king of all creation. And so, friends, get this. We don't vote him into office. John chapter 15, Jesus says, you didn't choose me. He says, I chose you. I voted for you. You didn't vote for me. Friends, that is the significance of handing these election ballots or these final exams to Jesus, that as he was grading these exams, pass or fail, some people had an exam that was, it was like it was stamped pass by their politicians and their political parties, but Jesus failed it. So friends, you can pass with people and politicians and fail with Jesus, but you can also fail with people and pass with Jesus. That's the importance of him grading the exams, friends. It wasn't a final exam in the sense of heaven and hell, but it was a final exam, friends, as it pertains to God's purposes in America and the church's relationship to the United States of America. There was a sense of finality that this was the last time to grade. He was grading us this last time. There was a sense of finality. So here's a few things. Remember, I sometimes say that it is not our faith alone in the last times that's going to be tested. It's our allegiance that's going to be tested. Please keep that in mind if you are a Christ follower. So a few things, friends. What does he grade us on? I'm going to give you three general things that Jesus grades us on according to his word in terms of how we vote, in terms of what this exam was like and what he was paying attention to. Number one, friends, the gospel he was grading us on, the true gospel of the kingdom of God. Heaven's number one agenda is not politics, friends. Come on, it's not all these healthcare issues, all the things that are human issues for us. Heaven's number one agenda is the gospel of the kingdom of God. And so he was grading these election ballots from Christians based upon how we supported the gospel, the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, the true gospel includes all of the issues that people lobby about, all of the issues that people fight about and the politicians debate about and promise people, friends, health care, justice, all those things. Friends, when the true gospel is preached, all of those things are addressed. And let me take a moment here to really say that may God forgive those of us who are pastors and preachers who have not preached the true gospel and represented the true gospel, which includes all of those things. Let me give an example. I sometimes share with our leaders in our church, friends, you never, ever, under any circumstances, put qualifiers or adjectives in front of the gospel. So in other words, there's no such thing as the social gospel, the social justice gospel or prosperity gospel. Friends, even though the gospel produces social justice, and really the better term is righteousness. God calls it righteousness and sometimes justice. He's the God of justice. You can't have real conversations about justice and righteousness without talking about God. So you never call it the social justice gospel, but the gospel does produce social justice, friends. Just like you never refer to it as prosperity gospel, although the gospel causes people to prosper. Here's the problem. Whenever you put an adjective in front of the gospel, it perverts the gospel. The gospel comes first, and then that qualifies all of the benefits and the blessings and all of the expressions of the gospel come after that. So the gospel brings prosperity. The gospel produces justice in society, but you never put an adjective or a qualifier in front of the gospel, because the moment you do, you pervert it. What's the problem with that, friends? Whenever you put something in front of the gospel, it changes the nature of the gospel. I believe that a great mistake that many pastors are making, very similar to myself, is that we're not helping people understand the difference between sociology and theology, which is rooted in God's plan to primarily save sinners around this issue of the gospel. That's the problem when we follow politicians instead of leading politicians to Christ. Number one, he was grading us on the preaching of the true gospel. Number two, he was grading us on marriage and family. The election ballot, this final exam, he was grading the church on marriage and family and what we believe according to God's word. Friends, now listen, God's first plan was procreation. God's first plan, when he created, was procreation. Friends, get this, very simple. He created a man in his image and his likeness. God himself gave that man a wife, and then God commanded them. He didn't suggest, he commanded them to be fruitful and to multiply, to have a family and to produce children. Really, really simple, but very, very profound, this plan for marriage and family that comes from God. Friends, here's the issue. We've gotten smarter than God to reject his plan and to create our own plan in terms of what marriage and family is. And Jesus is grading this idea concerning the church. That's why, friends, you cannot teach biblical morality concerning marriage and family and teach evolution. I believe this is why they want to push evolution and get creationism out of our education system, friends, because when you get rid of creationism, you get rid of the sovereignty of God. Evolution allows man to write the definition of his own morality. So we can create marriage and family to be whatever we want to be. If I want to marry this table and say that's how I feel, that's just kind of, you know, how I want to do it, then I can create my own morality when I get rid of the authority of the scriptures. And so I believe that's one of the reasons evolution is being pushed and creationism is being pushed out, because it gets rid of God's original plan for procreation through a man and a woman having children. Again, friends, please hear my heart. I'm saying this with humility. I'm not here to hurt or harm anyone, but to help and really to encourage and just to represent the truth of God's word. Again, friends, whenever we eliminate God from the equation, friends, it opens the way for us to write and define our own morality. Take a look at Jude chapter 1, verse 7. It says, "And don't forget Sodom and Gomorrah and their neighboring towns, which were filled with immorality and every kind of sexual perversion." Don't forget it. And it says that those cities were destroyed by fire and serve as a warning of the eternal fire of God's judgment. Friends, this is what happened when people began to tamper with God's plan. It says, remember what happened in Sodom, how God burned up the entire, burned up those cities. And as a reminder of God's judgment against it, every politician, I believe, needs a good Bible class. And so he's grading us on marriage and family. Within that, you can include he's grading us on abortion. That's included in marriage and family, friends. Psalm 127, verse 3, it says, behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. Listen, friends, the fruit of the womb is a reward. So, friends, whatever is inside of a woman's womb, God considers it to be a heritage or a gift and a reward. It's a good thing that God pays attention to and he honors it. Whatever is inside the womb is holy to God, and we are aborting what's inside of the womb by the millions, friends. This is such a tragedy. This is something that really makes me weep as a Black American father, because this is a big problem in the Black community. And as a pastor, I've sat with young ladies and pleaded with them to not get abortion. And I've had a chance to see those kids grow up and do great things and be great people. They are a blessing because they were not aborted, friends. The Lord is judging based upon this issue. He's grading these issues in terms of how we vote, friends. We sometimes often speak of a woman's right to choose. But friends, we never talk about the right of Jesus to choose, who is the author and the prince of life. We never talk about his right to choose. We just talk about a woman's right to choose, friends. This vision, he's grading these final exams, these ballots, in terms of how people were voting, especially the church. Last thing here, Israel, God's covenant people and God's covenant nation. He was grading us based upon our relationship to Israel. Remember distinctly, God tells Abraham, the father of the Jewish people and the nation of Israel, I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. Friends, there is a blessing and a curse inherent. God himself implements based upon how nations really treat the nation of Israel. Psalm 122, verse 6 says, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. May they prosper who love Jerusalem, God's capital city. I believe that's one of the reasons why America has skyrocketed to the top we're one of the youngest nations around, but we've bypassed other nations in terms of success and prosperity. I believe to some degree, it has to do with our commitment to the nation of Israel and this promise from God that he would prosper nations and people who bless Israel and take care of Israel, friends. So here's the last thing I just want to share with you, friends. As you can see, my skin is pretty dark. Look at that pretty brown skin, friends. And I'm saying that for a reason, just in light of all of the issues that are happening in race in America concerning race right now, friends. I sometimes jokingly tell people, you know what? I don't bleach. I don't tan. My skin is perfect. It's just right, friends. It's just the way that God made me. So it's perfect. I love it just like it is. I don't need to change anything, friends. So get this. My life matters. Brown skin, brother. My son, his life matters. My wife, my daughter, their lives matter. Everybody who looks like me, their lives matter. And I can say that, and I can say that people who don't look like me, their lives matter, because from on the authority of God's word, again, as a preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ, apolitical, zero victim of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of the living God, everyone is dear to the heart of God, and Jesus shed his blood for all mankind. And so he does not compartmentalize people the way that we are socially and politically in the world that we're living in right now. I matter. I matter to God, most importantly. But here's the deal. The reason I'm saying that, friends, is because racism is not the biggest issue on God's agenda. Even though I believe right now, unfortunately, this election has now become Black against white. Really sad. Even more so than Democrat against Republican. The problem is that we're now more concerned with right and left than we are concerned with right and wrong. Biblical morality, friends. And so I believe this thing has become a racial issue. It's not good for our nation. But I'm saying that racism is not the biggest issue on heaven's agenda, that Jesus was not judging us or grading us based upon racism. Friends, you know, racism is not an unpardonable sin. I have no problem forgiving racists. I love racists. I've told our church sometimes, man, I love the Grand Dragon or the Grand Wizard of the KKK. I love him. I really do. I don't know him, but I love him because God's put something in my heart to love my enemies. That's what Christ has done for me. And so the racism stuff doesn't work on me. We sometimes quote the scriptures, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Racism is a weapon. It doesn't prosper. It doesn't work against me. It just doesn't work. You can't get me with the race things. you have to get me with principles, the things that Jesus is grading in the earth, friends. And so here's the issue. Racism is not really the problem. Racism is a symptomatic consequence of us not doing something else that God tells us to do, which is to love. Here's again the problem, friends. When you take the scriptures, when you take words like love and justice out of the context of the scriptures of God, who is love, who defines justice, when you take the words, the terms love and justice out of the context of the scriptures and you put them into sociology, the meaning changes. The meanings change. Friends, that even though you're using the same words, those words don't mean the same thing in society that they do in the scriptures. No politician can tell you about the agape love of God. No politician can tell you about the righteousness, the standard of righteousness of Jehovah Tsidkenu, who is the God of righteousness and justice. No politician can explain that to you. And that is the biblical context of love and justice that you'll never get on CNN, MSNBC, Fox News, or any other the media outlets, friends. That is where the preachers of God, of the gospel of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of God, like myself, we have to be true to the scriptures, friends. Listen, racism is a symptomatic consequence of the absence of love. And get this, friends, that is why, again, God is being pushed out of society. But get this, a godless society is a loveless society. And a loveless society, a godless society, is needed for racism to thrive. For it can only be perpetuated in a conversation where the love of God is absent. Friends, that is why we have to preach the gospel of the kingdom of God, friends. Again, it is not my intent to hurt or to harm. I'm not here to offend anyone, just to preach the word of God and to be as true to it as I possibly can. My advice to every Christ follower, friends, going into this election, we have just about 3 months, considering that Jesus himself, I believe, will grade how we vote, how we conduct ourselves, especially concerning the church and God's purposes and plans for America. The Bible says to blow the trumpet in Zion. Joel prophesied, blow the trumpet in Zion. Didn't say blow the trumpet in the White House or in the halls of Congress. Wake up and warn the church of Jesus Christ. Friends, my advice to you as a fellow believer is to earnestly pray and fast, to press into a place of humility. Pray Psalm 139, I believe it is. Lord, search my heart. Search my heart, O God. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts and see if there's any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Ask the Lord to search your heart and to reveal to you his truth inside the answer key of his word, by which he grades and judges every Christ follower, and by which he is able to facilitate his plans and purposes for America in and through the church of Jesus Christ, our preaching and our prayers, friends. This is the time we need to see God unlike ever before. Thanks for your time. I wanted to take a moment to discharge this. I pray that it was a blessing to you, friends. Leave me some comments. Drop some information down in the comments. Let me know where you are. Let me know that you're praying with us. I honor you. I really appreciate being with you. And please make sure you subscribe to and follow my YouTube channel, youtube.com/James E. Ward Jr. Friends, it's good to be with you. I'll talk to you next time. God bless.